Hello, I'm Pastor Paul Thompson of East St. Olaf Lutheran Church and West St. Olaf Lutheran Church here outside Rochester, Minnesota, and I welcome you to our time of Lenten worship and devotion. God's blessings be with us all as we gather and share the good news of Jesus Christ our Lord. We begin. Jesus Christ is the light of the world, a light no darkness can overcome. Stay with us, Lord, for it is evening and the day is almost over, and illumine your church. Let us pray. Let the incense of our repentant prayer ascend before you, O Lord, and let your loving kindness descend upon us, that with purified minds we may sing your praises with the church on earth and the whole heavenly host, and may glorify you forever. Amen. Our first reading is from the 16th chapter of the book of Acts, starting at the 11th verse. Paul and his companions set sail from Troas and took a straight course to Samothrace, the following day to Neapolis, and from there to Philippi, which is a leading city of the district of Macedonia and a Roman colony. We remained in the city for some days. On the Sabbath day, we went outside the gate by the river, where we supposed there was a place of prayer, and we sat down and spoke to the women who gathered there. A certain woman named Lydia, a worshiper of God, was listening to us. She was from the city of Thyatira and a dealer in purple cloth. The Lord opened her heart to listen eagerly to what was said by Paul. When she and her household were baptized, she urged us, saying, "If you have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come and stay at my home." And she prevailed on us. Thus ends the first reading. Our second reading is from the 12th chapter of the Gospel of John. We begin at the 20th verse. Now among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew, and then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor." Thus ends the reading. Dear friends, grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. 4 weeks seems like a lifetime, doesn't it? We began our study of the rivers of the Bible 4 weeks ago, and the world is an incredibly different place now than it was then. From being free to go and when and where we please to being in our homes pretty much full time. From speaking face to face to speaking to each other on screens like the one you're looking at right now. From sharing the Lord's Supper all together in one place to not sharing the Lord's Supper at all. But as Jacob or Israel learned last week, and as God proved 2 weeks before that, God is with us still. So together we worship, we learn, and we believe. We've come to the fifth in our five studies of rivers, and this fifth river we're going to talk about tonight is smaller than the Jabbok that we studied last week, which was just a tributary and was smaller than the River Jordan, which we studied 2 weeks ago, which was much, much smaller than the Nile, which we studied 3 weeks ago. This week we'll talk about a river that isn't even named in the Bible, a river small enough that most of us could jump across if we wished. It ran near a town called Philippi in northeastern Greece. Philippi was founded 3.5 centuries before the time of Christ, and its name at that time was Crinides. Most towns throughout history founded themselves near sources of water, which in many places meant founding it near rivers. So you both had a way to get to and from the town, get goods to and from market, but also had good, reliable, fresh water to drink. Crinitis was named not for a river, but for a natural fountain in that area. It was the fountain, not the river, that was important. The river was insignificant, too small to navigate and too small to provide a decent amount of drinking water for irrigation or for any other useful purpose. It was the fountains that drew people's attention. The fountains and, oh, a gold mine that happened to be in the area, but in any case, just two decades after it was founded, the Macedonian king Philip II, who was the father of Alexander the Great, he took the town over, conquered it as a part of his many conquests of the whole Greek peninsula. Philip renamed it Philippi after himself and used it as a fortification to control one of the roads that passed through there and get better control of the area of Greece. The years went by, however, and the empire built by him and increased greatly by his son Alexander failed. And the Roman Empire came in. Philippi, despite never boasting more than 2,000 people in any time, continued as well. The biggest event in its history was a battle fought there in 42 BC. But it was part of the Roman Civil War when forces led by senators Brutus and Cassius, who had assassinated Julius Caesar, met up against forces of Mark Antony and Octavius, who were allies of Caesar. After that battle, Brutus and Caesar were killed, and it settled the civil war. Eventually, Octavius became the emperor and was known by Augustus. Some of the veterans of that battle were allowed to settle right there in Philippi, and they Romanized the whole area. They built a forum, they built three basilicas, and they also built an outdoor amphitheater. It was indeed a leading city of that district. Some 25 years after the life of Jesus, Paul found that very city. He had been traveling with his assistant Silas and a new recruit named Timothy and a physician named Luke. We are fortunate that Luke was there because he witnessed all these events firsthand and wrote them down in what we call the Book of Acts. He says they'd been visiting towns in the areas of Phrygia and Galatia in what is now the modern-day nation of Turkey. He had started churches there, and he hoped to move on to the area called Asia, which is not the same Asia, which is the whole continent that it runs east of Turkey, but just a little area, a Roman province, within that peninsula of Turkey. He wanted to go there, but for some reason, we are not told, he was forbidden by the Holy Spirit. So Paul said, okay, I'll go to Bithynia. But this time, the Spirit of Jesus did not allow them, in the words Luke recorded. We don't know what happened. Perhaps Paul had had a dream saying he couldn't go into Asia or Bithynia. Perhaps he'd had some other kind of a vision. Perhaps he just had trouble making arrangements to get into those areas, and he just described those difficulties to the resistance of the Spirit. We don't know for sure. But we do know that not being allowed to go where he wanted to go, having been told no twice by God, he went down to Troas, a seaport, to try to figure out where he should go next. And it was while there he had a dream. In the dream he saw a man from Macedonia who pleaded, come over to Macedonia and help us. Macedonia was just a short boat ride across the Aegean Sea from Troas, so off Paul and his party went. That reminds me of the way Greek people came to see Jesus right there in Jerusalem, his last week of life. They came up to his disciple Philip and said, we want to see Jesus. And Philip went and told Andrew, who was a lot closer to Jesus than he was, and the two of them asked Jesus. And Jesus saw now was the time for him to be glorified. Now his work had been done. His word was going to go out beyond just his own people and be established around the world among Greek people and all the peoples of the earth. Jesus' encounter with those Greeks is just a foreshadowing of what happened in Paul's encounter with the people he met in Macedonia. Luke tells us they landed in Samothrace and made their way west into Macedonia proper. This is where our story turns. Luke tells us in verse 15 of Acts 16. On the Sabbath day, we went outside the gate by the river, where we supposed there was a place of prayer. I cannot figure this out. There was nothing in his Jewish upbringing that said a river should be a place of prayer. His people had worshipped on mountaintops over the years, on plains. They'd worshipped in temples and in homes, and eventually in synagogues, but not rivers. But somehow, in some fashion, Paul had a feeling there would be some worshipers there. And lo and behold, there were. Luke continues, we sat down and spoke to the women who had gathered there. Spoke to them sounds like they're just casual conversation, and maybe it started out that way, but somehow something more happened. Luke explains, a certain woman named Lydia, a worshiper of God, was listening to us. She was from the city of Thyatira and a dealer in purple cloth. After Paul and his party had spoken their piece, this woman was somehow deeply touched. Luke tells us, the Lord opened her heart to listen eagerly to what was said by Paul. And soon enough, she and her whole household, her family, friends, servants, whoever was with her, they all were baptized with her. In this way, through the guidance of the Holy Spirit, through the preaching of Paul and the open heart of Lydia, the gospel of Jesus Christ made its way into Europe. That meant the gospel came into Rome, the Roman Empire. And the fact that it got into Rome meant it got everywhere else in that part of the world, into Spain and Gaul, which is now France, and into Germany even. And because it got into Germany, eventually over the years, it worked its way up into Scandinavia, where I know a lot of you watching now, your ancestors came from. Your ancestors were the beneficiaries of this passage of the gospel from one place to the next to the next. The Spirit coming to those people by that river Philippi, a river so insignificant as to not even have a name, tied God to all people. The God who created all things and nurtured them to the rivers of Eden. The God who provided refuge for his people along the banks of the Nile. The God who connected us to his Son by baptism in the Jordan River. The God who named them as people who struggle alongside him. As we found out by the River Jabbok last week, God connected us with himself. We don't need visions or dreams like Paul had. We have the word of the living God, which came through Paul. We have the vision, we have the truth, the gospel of God, who came to earth as Jesus, the anointed one, who is called the Messiah, the Christ. And in that word we see here, that word recorded that's been passed on to us, we can have trust. A discussion rose on the internet lately. What is one thing I will never change my mind about, no matter how hard you try? Most of the stuff that people listed that they weren't willing to change their mind about was stuff that I wouldn't change my mind about either. I would never change my mind about the existence of God. I would never change my mind about the fact that the earth really is round. I would never change my mind about the fact that people really did walk on the moon. I know those things, but I'm called to have faith, which is more than just knowing. Faith is more than just having an immovable idea in our heads. Faith is trusting in God so much that you're willing to go to any extent and do anything for God's people. These times when we're so separated from one another, it's especially important for us to think of ways we can continue to reach out to other people. Times are getting bad and they're going to get worse. People are going to need more and more. And food pantries and homeless shelters and women's shelters and other things are going to be pressed to the ultimate limits and perhaps even beyond. We need to be thinking about those people. We need to be thinking about how we can tell the world about that same Jesus by our generosity with them. My prayer is that we have the faith of Lydia, a faith that believes merely the word, but which is all the word we need. The message of God's grace that comes to us through this word written in that book, by our washing in baptism, and by the meal given to us in Christ, is a truthful word, is a powerful word, is a life-giving and life-changing word. It's a word that holds us together even when we are apart. It is a word that strengthens us even when we are weak. It is a word that calms us even when we are scared and confused. It is the word of the one and the only true God. Amen. And may the Lord our God, may the Lord our God and our Savior Jesus Christ bless and keep you now and always. Amen. Let us pray. Lord God, you have called your servants to ventures of which we cannot see the ending, by paths as yet untrodden, through perils unknown. Give us faith to go out with good courage, not knowing where to go, but only that your hand is leading us and your love supporting us through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And then we pray together our Lord's words. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now may the Almighty and Merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit bless and preserve you. Amen. I've been Pastor Paul Thompson. It's been a pleasure to be with you. God bless and keep you all.